The cold waters of the Tasman Sea, off the southeast coast of Australia, set the stage for a drama in which one man looks, quite literally, into the jaws of death.
I was going out for a typical day's diving down to one of my favourite areas, which is called Cape Howe.
Below, visibility is poor. A typical day for abalone fishing.
I was about to bump off a good-sized abalone and a huge force hit me. Everything went black.
Half of Eric's body is inside the jaws of a massive great white.
I felt like a vice-like pressure upon my chest and back. I didn't realize I was actually in a shark until it shook me sideways. I realized I was actually getting eaten alive. I've never felt fear like that in my entire life. I really thought my time was up.
Great whites ambush their prey at speeds of up to 20 miles per hour and tend to strike from behind and below. Eric's head-on encounter with the shark is unusual, and it gives him a fighting chance.
I put my hand up on the side of the shark's face and felt an object like half a tennis ball covered in slimy membrane. I'd found the eye.
He squeezes it, and the shark briefly opens its jaw. Eric starts to back out.
But the bottom jaw closed again, this time over my face mask. I felt my nose break and some teeth started to penetrate in the back of my head.
Bleeding and running out of breath, he squeezes the eye again and he's free. He immediately finds his air regulator and takes a huge breath. Then he begins a slow, terrifying ascent to the surface.
The shark just cruised around me in slow circles, staring at me. And although I didn't have my face mask, I could see quite clearly, because the shark was so close to me, that it was a great white. The fear of that was almost too much to bear.
Keeping cool under incredible pressure, Eric realizes that a fast, panicky ascent will signal the shark that he's in trouble and invite another attack. Instead, he moves slowly to the surface, holding out his bag of abalone as a distraction should the shark move in for a second try.
Just that anticipation probably was my greatest fear, actually thinking that I was going to get eaten again. If that shark wanted me, it had me.
After the longest minute of his life, Eric breaks the surface and shouts to his son for help.
The main thing was I was thinking was I need to get him back to shore before he loses too much blood.
With a row of puncture wounds across his chest and back, Eric is sped back to port, and Mark puts out a call for help. 1 hour later, Eric and Mark arrive at Eden Wharf. By then, an astonished crowd is there to see the incredible sight of Eric stepping onto the dock under his own power, his catch of abalone firmly in hand. But how can he do this after being half swallowed by a giant shark? Contrary to popular belief, the bite pressure of a shark's jaw is hardly more than that of a human's. It's the razor-sharp teeth that do the damage. The edges of its teeth are actually serrated, so when a shark shakes its prey sideways, it creates a sawing action, cutting into the flesh. Eric's lead weight vest absorbed the cutting power of the serrations and consequently saved his life. While the vest spared his body from serious damage, some psychological wounds took longer to heal.
I'd wake up in cold sweats several times through the night. I kept reliving the attack all the time. My mind would go over it and over it as I was trying to sleep, and I could still relive every detail.